morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
Gee, I had to spend a while looking for my flashlights and those handy little headlamps this week. It seems it's pretty dark when I go out to find a horse to saddle in the morning now. But we get it done, and as I ride, I wonder what's ahead for our industry and the world of ranching, horses, and livestock. Well, Baxter Black has some thoughts about what fast food might be doing in the meat industry today.
Now, the meat industry is on a crash course to design heat and serve entrees. They're responding to the needs of families who have neither the time or interest to prepare anything more complicated than microwave fish sticks.
I'll visit with a couple of longtime friends today who have shared lots of laughs and good times together, but they take ranching very seriously.
And I really think it's a shame that agriculture can't support itself. I mean, there is hardly a family in our country that doesn't have off-farm income.
And the Rangeland News looks at the outlook for farm and ranch income.
Median on-farm income and median off-farm.
And in the cowboy poetry spotlight,
the animals have all moved lower, and the bears sleep an unknowing sleep. They feel not the cold winds in the winter, as they dream of the salmon, silver and sleek.
That's the late Charlie Camden, much-loved packer, cowboy, and poet that you'll hear today. On the Urban Saddles and Western Wear horse training file, don't panic just because that horse got loose. And, you know, these fall days are pretty much cowboy heaven around here. Deep blue skies, crisp, cool nights, warm afternoons, and as I ride to the top of the ridge and survey all the incredible beauty of the West, I think of a song like this one from Red Steagall.
The works are almost over, we've brought the year about. We'll throw them beeves and cattle cars, we'll turn the cabbie out. So long we'll say, a-wondering where the time has flown. When the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home. When the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home. Late October afternoons are honey in the comb. I'll settle up my wages, saddle up my roan. When the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home. When frost is on the morning and the moon shows hints of snow, some see a time for parting and some for letting go. But I don't pine, for every day is like a precious stone. When the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home. When the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home. Late October afternoons are honey in the comb. I'll settle up my wages, saddle up my roan. When the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home. I have someone waiting with a sparkle in her. We'll catch up on the gossip as we pass the by and by. Not worrying the winter, the days are all our own. When the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home. When the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home. Late October afternoons are honey in the comb. I'll settle up my wages, saddle up my roan when the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home. I'll saddle up my wages, saddle up my roan when the cottonwoods are yellow and the wagon's headed home.
Our good friends Jim and Jackie Anderson are second-generation ranchers, and they've made the operation successful with a lot of hard work and innovation and a sense of humor. Now, Billy and I have had some great visits around their kitchen table, but this story from Jim actually came from one of our Spirit of the West cruises, and I guess maybe some sensitive listeners may be slightly offended at the story, but my goodness, this stuff happens. Here's Jim.
Well, the only reason I mention this to you is that it's a story that I think Baxter Black would have a real hoot with. But anyway, I thought you might be interested in hearing this too. It's we had a local bull sale in Rimby. So Jackie and I went up just for the evening. It was an evening bull sale, and I didn't really need a bull. Matter of fact, I didn't need a bull, but I just thought it's kind of fun to bullshit with the guys that are there and see who's there and stuff. So we toured through the bulls, and then the sale started. So we found ourselves a seat in the bleachers there, and the sale was happening, and there was this red Angus bull come in, and geez, I felt the need to pass some gas. Real bad.
I've been in that situation. I haven't admitted it publicly.
So Jackie and I were just sitting there, and I kind of, who was up there to behind me, and there's anybody over there that, you know, if I did would offend anybody, and there wasn't anybody really close, and so I just kind of let things go. And you know, I was sitting there, this bull was selling and they were bidding away, and then all of a sudden the smell of this mustard gas came by, and I went like this, and I just went like this, and the auctioneer took it for a bid. And this bull was, he was bidding at $2,500 or $2,700, and I didn't even want a Red Angus bull. And I hear I'd bid on this bull, and I sure didn't know what to do next. And I was trying to think, what am I going to say if he declares it sold? And luckily, somebody else bid afterwards, and I sure didn't bid again.
I never heard of that happening. Man, oh, man.
I always call that one the cost of a fart.
Does he do this often, Jack?
Yeah.
Well, Jim and Jackie will share some of the innovations that they've introduced and share some very interesting stories. And there's another song that sure captures the feeling of the fall roundup when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West, a great song about how it is in cattle country in the fall from Bren Hill coming up, and I know you'll enjoy it. After we get back to the visit with ranchers Jim and Jackie Anderson.
Can you just tell me a little bit about your operation at home, exactly where it is, and cow-calf, how you run things, kind of?
Well, we ranch about 2 hours northwest of Calgary, just outside of Red Deer. We are a second-generation farmer. We have a section of land there, and my dad bought the place in 1946 after the war, and I was born and raised there, so Jackie and I still live there. We run, our income is mostly cow-calf. We do have the background in our feedlot opportunity, so we assess what to do with our calves based on what the market's at when the time comes. Sometimes we can finish them. We have the ability to finish them, or we can background them for 4 months, or we can sell them right off the cow, whichever we feel at the time is the most attractive financially. And we do some mixed farming too, some grain farming, and that complements our cattle operation. And we try to be pretty well independent of, the only thing we ever buy off farm is salts and minerals. Other than that, our feeds and our proteins are all supplied by our own acreage. And that's kind of nice because it does impact our cost of production.
Are your summer pastures all deeded land adjoining the ranch, or do you have half the truck cows out to summer grazing someplace else?
Well, we're able to keep everybody home. We took cattle to Saskatchewan 1 year because we were short of pasture. And St. Paul another year, we took 2 liner loads up there because the grass wasn't recovering. We also sell market a little bit of hay if we have the opportunity. And we market construction-grade straw bales pretty well every year. And then we have the frost-free nose pump venture that sort of is supposed to supply us a bit of an income.
This kind of diversification is really, it's becoming more important all the time, though, isn't it? To find ways, whether you've got marketable timber or oil leases or you're distributing products or you're using some other resources, doing custom work. It's a situation where you have to do more than just depend on those calves now, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right, Hugh. And I really think it's a shame that agriculture can't support itself. I mean, there is hardly a family in our country that doesn't have off-farm income. And up to the last few years, we've been able to accomplish that. Just we're strictly farmers, but through need, we've have to come up with some other opportunities. And like you mentioned, oil revenues a bit, and we do have logging capacity potential. We found a niche market with construction-grade straw bales. We found a bit of a market with the frost-free nose pumps. And if we have the cropping in the year, we can market some second-cut alfalfa as a specialty hay. So things are changing and demanding that producers keep up with changes or else you get left behind.
Well, Jackie Anderson is kind of proud of how well she can back up a stock trailer. And she remembers an old wild cow that was having trouble calving. And you'll be surprised at how they risked life and limb to save that calf. Meanwhile, in the golden hills of Utah, no doubt Bren Hill is spending a lot of hours in the saddle. Always loved this one of his.
Frost on the wheat grass, frost on the sage, frost on the aspen leaves, steam on the lake. The blue autumn sky's turning colder by the day, and it's time to get this roundup party underway. So buckle on your leggings, get your saddle cinched up tight for the roundup. Burns tonight. Cattle on the skyline, cattle in the trees, riders close behind them, and freedom on the breeze. Well, this way of life is getting older by the day, and it's time to get this roundup party underway. So rousing up your ropes and spur your ponies quick and light for the roundup fire burns tonight. I spent the summer waiting, working on the land, and I spend the winter waiting for the time to break. I spend a lifetime riding through the sage. It's burning in my blood, there is no other way. You can call me crazy, say whatever you will say, but it's time to get this roundup party underway. So buckle on your leggings, get your saddle cinched up tight for the roundup. Yeah, the roundup fire burns tonight.
Well, you may have been at an RV park somewhere and watched a city guy struggle to get his holiday trailer backed in place without hitting the wood stove or the picnic table or maybe his wife. But ranch wives usually have no trouble backing up a trailer, as Jackie Anderson explained.
And are you as good with machinery as most wives are? I mean, most wives are pretty good going frontwards with a truck or a truck and trailer or whatever, but when it comes to backing up, sometimes...
I've had lots of practice backing up, Hugh. We have a feed alley that in order to feed, you have to back the whole length of the alley before you can go forward and feed. So I had to learn that early in our career. So I'm pretty good backing up, but I'll tell you what I'm not good at is if anything breaks down, then I have to call for Jim.
What about calving? Most couples that I know of in a ranch situation have got a few calving stories and a few calving episodes, and are you both involved in that? Do you calve a lot of heifers? Is there any of this getting up in the middle of a cold, frosty February morning and going out and checking?
I think this is going to be our last year. When we get back, shortly after we get back, we'll start calving. But I think we're holding the bulls a little longer for next year. We're just getting a little tired of this winter calving. But we have had some exciting winter calving stories. And I think my favorite one was the time that we had an old wild cow that we always hoped we never had to help. And this one time I was watching her because Jim was at a meeting and she wasn't making much progress. So finally I had to call him and we went out there, and what he had to do was he kind of slithered through the straw. She was bedded down, and he kind of slithered through the straw and managed to get the chains on her without her knowing. And then he attached the lariat to the chain, a little bit like one of those stories that you told us today, Hugh. Well, thank heavens he didn't get his hand caught in there. And then he attached the lariat to the post in the shed. And
so both back feet, or both front feet of the calf, were protruding enough you could get the chains on.
We could get the chains on him, and the only way I was able to do that is that we calve in a shed with lights on it, and I shut the lights off, and so she couldn't see me, and I was able to get the chains on. And then once I had it tied, the lariat tied to a pole, we turned the lights on. Well, this cow popped up and she saw me, and she come running after me until she got to the end of the lariat. And it wasn't enough to calve her out at the moment, but
we did manage to get her calved out.
And it was a tremendous calf. It was a big calf, and it was a difficult presentation for her. And lucky for us it was, because we got the calf out, and we pulled it just across the front of her nose there so she could mother it. Well, she was wanting to kill me in the worst way. She'd lay in there with her mouth wide open and a screaming and a hooting at me, but she couldn't get up. That was my only salvation, that she couldn't get after me. So we just pulled the calf across the front of her face, and we just left her. And in a couple hours, she was up, but she had mothered the thing, and everything was fine. But it was just a pretty spooky situation, because they can take after you, and you can't do anything about it.
I know.
If you're not ready.
Well, there's more from this great ranch and couple in a little while. And next, Baxter Black analyzes what the fast food industry is doing to livestock producers. Another one of those great songs about the fall roundup, and then the rangeland news when the spirit of the West continues right after this.
Howdy, friends. This is Baxter Black on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan, and I'll be right back after this with a little peek at the 3 R's of cooking meat.
Your land is a legacy, a challenge from those who tended it before you, to build on their foundations. At Corteva AgriScience, we understand what it means to be the stewards of a legacy. We embrace the challenge of building on the foundation of Dow AgroSciences to maintain your trust, to bring new solutions, to help you care for your land. See how we can help build your legacy at rangeandpasture.com.
And for our Canadian listeners, just check Corteva.ca, the Canadian website.
We all know how good it is to be invited to someone's house for supper, and they serve steaks from their backyard grill that melt in your mouth. It is possible that the chef took an elective course in ribs, roasts, and rack o' lamb while he or she completed their library science degree in college. It is a weekly, hands-on, 3-hour class for credits that introduces interested students to the art of cooking meat. It used to be called home economics. The class in the 3 R's of cooking meat entrees has attracted many from outside the ag school. It can be said of most college students that they are motivated, and it is a status symbol in the urban world to know about wine, to be able to snow ski, or to cook. And I don't mean pastry or jelly or macaroni and cheese, but to grill steaks and smoke ribs. This skill is a definite plus in attracting the opposite sex, one of the most popular extracurricular activities. This course is not designed to qualify them as a chef at Denny's or Deli's or the Marriott at Lake Louise. It's for backyard chefs. Now, the meat industry is on a crash course to design heat-and-serve entrees. They're responding to the needs of families who have neither the time or interest to prepare anything more complicated than microwave fish sticks. Their products are good and being well-received, thus creating future generations of heat-and-serve households. And in such a community of non-cooks, a graduate of the 3 R's would be like a one-eyed man in the land of the blind. Now, I have to admit in my ignorance that I know of no ag colleges offering this course, But for those of us in the livestock business, we have a vested interest in household chefs who know how to cook meat. I appreciate there are those who might think this idea is silly, but when I read the profusion of superfluous helium-filled courses offered for college credit, ribs, roast, and rack of lamb doesn't sound so frivolous. Okay. Doing radio commentary is hard work. I hope my wife gets home in time to fix supper. Oh, well, if she doesn't, I can always microwave a hot dog. No, maybe I'll boil it. They taste better boiled. But it takes so long. I could just eat it raw with mustard if I've got some left over from the Chinese takeout. This is Baxter Black on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan, brought to you by Corteva Agriscience.
Not much can raise your stress level more than a tractor breakdown when you need it most. We've all spent hours on the phone and driving around trying to find the right parts, and that's no fun when you're missing something you need to finish the job. Here's a better way. Just go to bctractorparts.com. That's where you can find about any part for any mega tractor. If you're restoring a vintage tractor or just keeping up the maintenance on the ones you're using, you can have the parts you need in a short time. And you know what? There's some great pictures of tractor restoration projects and much more right there at bctractorparts.com. What? Oh, you don't have internet? Well, try calling Mark at 250-395-0960. Just ahead of the Rangeland News, one of two songs you'll hear today with almost the same title. Actually, they have the very same title. First, here's a guy with a real creative touch when it comes to writing contemporary songs of the West, Jim Reeder and The Gather.
I watch the sunset's glow caress the mountains and see the daylight pulled over the peaks. I'm reflecting on the cowboys of the roundups from 1881 to 93. Before the fences there were prairie oceans, waves of grass in rhythmic motion. There's a couple steers over here, boys, I'll push them through, you hit them down. Down, down, down to the gather. Down, down, down to the gather. Those free grazing cattle really travel scattered over thousands of square miles. We'd separate them by brand, then drive them homeward. 'Twas an honor to ride the roundup in the fall. There's a couple steers over here, boys, I'll push them through, you hit them down. Down, down, down to the gather. Down, down, down to the gather. The homesteads came, the rains last forever. Barbed wire fences kept those cattle close. And with it came the end of an era where cowboys rode like knights upon their horse. There's a couple steers over here, boys, I'll push them through, you hit them. Down, down, down.
the Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West, a roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, it says, how much money does the average farm family take in these days? Well, it is complicated what the farm or ranch actually earns from production, but here's an interesting report from Gary Crawford.
After 4 years of seeing yearly declines in income, the nation's farm operator households saw an increase in 2019 and may see another one this year.
Median on-farm income and median off-farm income is going up.
USDA's chief economist Rob Johansson says that median farm operator household income is projected to rise from 2019.
From $83,700 to $89,600.
Income the household will get from the farm will grow for only the second time in 24 years, mainly because of more government payments. Johansson says the off-farm earnings projections are a bit more tentative because economists don't yet know the full extent of layoffs and such caused by COVID-19. But on the plus side for income, there are
the stimulus payments. So the positive side is included, meaning that a lot of farm families receive stimulus payments.
But again, he says, we don't know the extent yet of the farm household's unemployment situation. When we have that, we'll have a much better idea of 2020 farm household incomes. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
Well, the other night when the day's work was done and supper was over, I sat in my chair and read through the September issue of Beef Illustrated, and I wound up reading the whole issue in one sitting before I could put it down. One of the gems was about a study from a Spanish scientist who spent a lot of years researching diet in human development. And according to him, among a lot of information he offered, relying on a vegan diet ends up damaging the kidneys, as vegan foods contain iron ions that are mostly not absorbed but excreted. He said animal protein represents 22% of the minimal energy value necessary for survival. And another column there I always look for is Bruce Dirksen's. Always great stories about riding pens with faithful old Sonny. And this one was a great commentary on what it takes to make good cattle. The scientists at the University of California, Davis, have successfully produced a bull calf that has been genome edited to produce more male offspring. They did this by inserting the SRY gene into the bovine chromosome 1-7. Well, that's got to be pretty fine work. But what does it mean? Well, the pregnancy for the 50-kilogram calf cost about $500,000 U.S., and a team of scientists were anxious to see if the calf would show how to put more steers on the market from the same cows. Theoretically, ranchers could produce the same amount of meat as their traditional herd, but with fewer animals, and they would still be able to produce some females as replacements while directing a higher portion of cattle to market. According to the USDA Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service, APHIS, vesticular stomatitis, that virus, has been confirmed in 8 states this year: Arizona, Arkansas, Kansas, Missouri, Nebraska, New Mexico, Oklahoma, and Texas. Vesicular stomatitis, of course, is a viral disease that primarily affects horses, cattle, and occasionally swine, sheep, goats, llamas, and alpacas. The Federal Court of Appeal of Canada has dismissed appeals by some of Canada's largest telephone and cable companies, handing an interim victory to the country's independent internet providers. And the court also ordered the network owners, including Bell, Rogers, and others, to pay costs to Tech Savvy Solutions Incorporated, which is the largest of Canada's independent internet service providers and an industry association. But it seems the Federal Court of Appeal isn't the only way that the big network owners have been fighting to prevent the CRTC from reducing the wholesale rates they charge to independent internet providers, which compete for some of the same customers. Boy, we could sure use an improvement in our internet speed and price and reliability here. Here's some good news. Production of season 14 of Heartland has gotten underway in Alberta. It started a little later than they had hoped for, but the work environment has sure changed due to the pandemic. But executive producer Tom Cox says, don't worry, all the necessary precautions are being taken to ensure the safety of the cast and crew. Looking forward to season 14. There is a special calf sale and a regular sale at the Kamloops Yards of the BC Livestock Co-op on September 29th, a special calf sale at the Williams Lake Yards on September 30th, and then the regular sale October 1st, and a pre-sort sale at the Vanderhoof Yards October 2nd. Get all the information, see the sales live at bclivestock.bc.ca. Boy, Larry and Wayne are busy this time of year. Meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, there's a pre-sort calf sale October 5th and another one October 19th, as well as regular cattle sales every Wednesday. You can bring your calves in on Sundays between 8 a.m. and 4 p.m. for the pre-sort sales, and you can call ahead to book them at 1-800-710-3166 or see InnisfailAuctionMarket.com. I've been waiting for this, the final item. A story about our dear friend, the cowboy preacher Bryn Thiessen. Apparently, the report says, Bryn had stopped his truck when he saw a young guy working like mad to get about 100 square bales loaded onto a wagon beside this all-mixed-up pile of bales. And Bryn said, "Young fella, you look really tired," and he offered him a cool drink, and he said, "You better take a little rest. You really look worn out." The young fella says, "No, my father would hate that." "Well, don't be silly," Bryn says. "Everybody needs a break once in a while. Come on, take some more cold water." And again, the young guy declines. And this goes on for a couple of minutes until Bryn says, "Well, your father must be quite a slave driver. Tell me where he is so I can go have a little talk with him." "Well," says the young fella, "he's under the bales." And that's the Rangeland News. Coming up in the Irvin Saddles and Western Wear horse training file, when a horse gets loose, sometimes folks tend to panic, but I'll have a few examples of how it works better if you don't, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Have you ever been in a situation where there are a few or maybe a bunch of folks with their horses and one of them gets loose? Not the folks, but the horse. How do they handle it? Well, I'll give you a few examples of how it can go on the Irvin Saddles and Western Wear horse training file. Right after some good advice from an old-timer, here's Tony Lunderbolt.
She was definitely a looker, don't think he had noticed. Just cause he was 83, his eyes were bright and focused. But when he saw these two young bucks with that mount of coup, said you better listen close, you need to hear the truth. Well, you call yourself a cowboy, well, you got a ways to go. Cause any real cowboy will take it nice and slow. If you wanna catch that pretty gal, then listen to what I say. It takes a lot of time and patience when it's done the cowboy way. This young cowboy tried to saddle up a horse. The bay was getting nervous, he was using too much force. The old man seen it coming long before he got a seat. He laughed and shook his head as he landed in a heap. Well, you call yourself a cowboy, well, you got a ways to go. Any real cowboy can take it nice and slow. If you wanna break that cayuse, then listen to what I say. It takes a lot of time and patience when it's done the cowboy way. Well, today's generation has really gone astray. Wish we could all get back to the good old cowboy way. Well, you call yourself a cowboy, well, you got a ways to go. Cause any real cowboy will take it nice and slow. If you really wanna live this life, then listen to what I say. It takes a lot of time and patience when it's done the cowboy way. It takes time and patience when it's done the cowboy way.
Ha ha ha!
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
It's true, folks are always telling me how much they love shopping at Irvine Tack and Western Wear, but many of them live way over yonder and far away, or they're still uneasy about heading too far from home. I tell them, no problem. Go to urbans.ca and shop online. It's all there. The biggest names in Western wear, oodles of saddles, and all that unique Western home decor. So giddy up and get online at urbans.ca today. Urban Tack and Western Wear,
Canada's largest Western store.
Sometimes they'll be okay if you just let them go. I watched an interesting situation the other day. A group of riders at a facility that boards and trains. It's only a couple acres in size, completely fenced around the outside and fenced into paddocks and a nice arena. And a person who boards their horse there was leading him across the arena. The wind blew a plastic bag past the horse. The horse pulled away, and he was running loose. Well, the owner panicked. Oh, no, my horse is loose, and the gate's open. He ran after the horse as fast as he could, chased him out the gate that led to an alley where his box stall stood with the door open, and the horse entered his stall and stopped. Does a loose horse always mean it's a panic situation? Not really. Here's another one. I rode my buckskin mare Lucky cross-country about 3 miles the other day to find a couple of mares that I had turned out in a fenced quarter section. The ground was now covered with snow, and they'd be doing real well, but it was time to bring them home. Now, it's a fairly long ride cross-country. About 400 acres I have to cross with no cross fences and lots of brush and canyons. So once I was out there and caught the mares, I thought, yeah, well, maybe I better hang on to them both in case they get away, right? Well, no, they've made this trip several times. I think they can remember where home is. And all I needed to do was lead the one we call Mystic. She's the young one that's barely broke. And good old Springer will either follow us or run ahead of us or tag along beside us. So far, so good. But after about 15 minutes, the fingers on my right hand were totally numb from holding the shank on Mystic's halter, like it was pretty darn cold. So enough of this, I says, and I undid the halter and slipped it off, and away went Mystic, about 100 yards up the trail. Oh, no, two loose horses. They might get away. Well, Mystic then stopped and turned around to make sure Lucky and I were coming. Lucky is the alpha mare in the bunch. When they all run free, she's the one that decides where they go to find water, and she makes sure that they all do it her way. And they knew they would be safe if they always had her in sight. Well, it took us about an hour and a half, and we all got home together, and it was about as easy or easier than trying to trail two or three pairs, cows and calves, across that same piece of country. Sometimes, if you know the surroundings and you know the horses, it's not always a panic situation if one gets loose.
And for Irvine Saddles and Western Wear, that's the Horse Training File. Something that really helps our horses, keeps them looking good and going well, is a daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration. And you can find out what's in it at hoffmanshorseproducts.com.
The 2020 Top Gun Fall Roundup Horse Sale is happening as an online timed auction October 8th to 10th. Starting October 5th, go online at topgunhorsesales.com to register as a buyer. Bidding opens at 9 a.m. October 8th Mountain Time and stays open till the final horse is sold October 10th. See the horses at topgunhorsesales.com and contact Jordan Dodds, 403-783-0246. The Top Gun Fall Roundup Horse Sale, following all the guidelines and making a great way to buy your next best horse. The way the Canada Revenue Agency deals with ranchers and farmers has changed a lot in the last few years, and the financial decisions we make today can have a long-lasting impact on our bottom line far into the future. It really helps to have a trusted professional who really understands your situation to guide you with all your accounting requirements and your tax preparation. Having an accountant who knows the difference between a Hereford and a heifer, what a slick and backgrounding are, and that Alfalfa and Timothy are not just names from a storybook really helps. Kathy McMillan of PMT Chartered Professional Accountants understands the intricacies of specialized programs like AgriStability and AgriInvest. She understands the demands on your time and can help you spend more time doing your job and less time dealing with endless piles of paperwork.
see PMTAccountants.com or call toll-free 877-383-8081. A short time ago, you heard Jim Reeder's original song, The Gather. And here's another original song with the same name, but it's different. Another one that comes to mind, though, on a quiet late September day on a good horse up in the high country. This is Wiley in the Wild West.
The sun is peeking over the ridge. The air is crisp. And the sky is big. Leaves are falling, the cattle are bawling, riding out on the gather. A cow dog is creeping with his head down low. Hooves are squeaking in the fresh falling snow. Morning's breaking, my soul is awakened, riding out on the gather. My pockets are empty, but I don't care. I know that I'm winning when I'm out there. Well, the magpies are cottonwood trees, and the river is tickled by a cool northern breeze. I can float like a feather when I'm sitting on the leather, riding out on the gather.
Happening in the fall, but this story took place kind of in late winter and early spring with Jim and Jackie Anderson.
We try to tag every calf with the matching number to his mother if we can when they're born, and most of them are pretty good, but boy, there's some of them where you don't want to be by yourself on knelt over putting the ear tag in that calf if that mother's anywhere behind you, you know.
And that's happened a time or two to me too, where they you sort of feel like you can trust them, and all of a sudden they've had enough. And you're out of there whether you like it or not, yep. And whether you're done or not.
Well, we had one bad one. Jim brought a cow in. He'd already tagged it, but he wasn't sure that she was getting milk, so he brought her in the next day. And he was a little lax because he thought she'd been fine the day before when he tagged it, but he got her in the corral, and I happened to be outside and saw it happening, thank heavens, but she got him down, and she wasn't going to quit. She broke his collarbone, and... between me and the dog, we managed to get her off of him long enough for him to get out of there, but that was the worst one.
And then she made me sell a cow. She was a great cow. She's a heck of
producer.
A great producer. Always had a nice calf, nice udder on her and everything. But
a good mother, too.
Jackie made me sell a cow.
Well, Jim and Jackie, it's just been great having you folks along with our gang here on the Spirit of the West, and thanks for sharing just a little bit with us today. That's great.
You're welcome, Hugh. It's great to be here with you guys, all of you.
And since we did that interview, Jim and Jackie's frost-free nose pumps have really become popular. Great way to have cattle water without having water freeze in the winter. You can find out more about it and see the demos and everything at frostfreenosepumps.com. Still to come, a classic Western song about this time of year and the cowboy poetry spotlight with the late Charlie Camden when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. The classic Western song for this week was originally recorded by the Sons of the Pioneers in 1963, and the first version I heard was by the Norman Luboff Choir with a full choral arrangement. It's been done by Riders in the Sky and Bob Wagner, among many others, written by the Nashville session piano player Don Robertson and Hal Blair, and this is, I think, one of the best arrangements, with the Rangeman featuring the voice and guitar of the late Jerry Compton.
When it's autumn on the trail and the leaves have turned to flame, I seem to hear the breeze wandering through the trees whispering your name. All along my lonely ride, how clearly I recall
when we traveled side by side. It was autumn on the trail that you loved the most of all. Ever think of me? Do you remember the lovely plans we made by the campfire's last glowing ember?
How I'm longing to return to the happy days we knew.
Oh, my darling, how I yearn when it's autumn on the trail to be sharing it with you.
Charlie Camden was kind of a legend. He was a well-known outfitter, hunter, hunting guide, packer from Washington State. And he was a great friend of toe-tapping Tommy Tucker, the longtime program director and air personality at KRLC in Lewiston, Idaho. And Charlie used to sit in with Tommy quite often on the program in the mornings. And I always enjoyed Charlie's narration of his own poem, Season's Last Ride.
Hoarfrost stands the hair on my ponies, pack ropes frozen hard in the coil. Shod hooves ring out like cathedral bells, on this high country, frozen, thin soil. Winter descends on the highlands as a gray org with an ice-taloned hand and makes sun rays slant from the distant south with summer chased to a distant land. The animals have all moved lower and the bears sleep an unknowing sleep. They feel not the cold winds in the winter as they dream of the salmon, silver and sleek. It's damn sure time to leave this high country. Heavy snow will soon claim it all. The camps and wild places lie beyond closed trails, and their good times mere memories to recall. My cabin waits by the river. Its fireplace beckons and glows, and I'll sit by its warmth on deep winter nights, sipping brandy as the bitter winds blow. Outside in the barn, my horses will nicker, in the warm stalls, secure and clean. And with their eyes half closed, they'll bury their nose in the rich hay, shaken loose and dark green. These saddles will hang from a lofty beam, with the ropes coiled neatly on the side, and the padding all hung to catch the air as they wait for next season's ride.
Well, thanks again for joining the ride, and I sure hope you can be back here next week at the same time. And thanks, of course, to the official Spirit of the West support crew. That's Mark and Kathy McMillan. And you know, if you enjoy this program, I know you'll love Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine. Subscribe online at cowboycountrymagazine.com. And I hope you can subscribe to our YouTube channel. It's SOTW55. And the video versions of all our shows are there, as well as lots of fun stuff, including the brand new Western Spirit Band's blooper rehearsal video. Didn't originally plan it to be a blooper reel, but that's how it turned out, and it's all there, uncut. And you can get this program, of course, as a podcast as well. The links are all at our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I am Hugh McLennan. We'll see you down the trail somewhere real soon.